you're going to see over the coming months. The Waterfront Development Corporation, I should just backtrack here. The Waterfront Development Corporation has held some open houses over the last few months, and I've attended two of the three and talked to people while they're there, and they've talked about, you know, their hopes and dreams for that area, because it's new land, and we don't often get that, and we certainly don't often get that on waterfronts. So what I've heard from a lot of people is they want to see more green. They want less density. They want to see iconic buildings. They want to use that waterfront. And I'll tell you, I talked to business owners, and they are excited about the possibility of locating down there. People say to me, I want to go for a walk on the waterfront with my spouse, with my pet. I want to be able to stop and have a coffee or a latte or something on that waterfront. I talk to other people, and they say, I want to be able to fish on that waterfront. And in fact, we do have a club called the Little Fishers that just started up last fall. It's a group of residents. Actually, I think a lot of them are actually from Sackville, but a lot of them come to the Bedford waterfront, and they're on the South Jetty, and they have this great club that they started up, and it's to help to teach kids how to fish. And I've been down there several nights. They do it on Friday nights. It's lots of fun. In fact, my husband went down with me one day, and he caught a squid in his bare hand. And fortunately, he moved at just the right point just before it squirted its ink out all over his new pants, because I would have been really cheesed off about that. But it's a really fun event for families. So people want to be able to use their waterfront. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. People want to be able to use the waterfront, and I think that you're going to see traffic, transit, and services study coming out from HRM soon. So we'll find out what they're saying. They may say, no, you can't do some of these things. They may say, if you want to put, say, 5,000 people on that waterfront, this is what you have to do. We'll just see what that study says. But when that study comes down, then we'll have a good idea where we're going in terms of traffic, transit, and services. From there, HRM will begin the consultation process where people will have the ability to have their say on what is going on the waterfront. There's a group, Save Bedford Waterfront, that has been quite active over the last while with concerns about the waterfront, and they will be able to come out and speak to it, as will, you know, anybody who is interested in those waterfront issues, and they will be able to come out, and I do hope that people will come out. One of my concerns was that I actually heard from people who said, I didn't know that there had been consultations. I didn't know there had been these big public meetings. And I said, I don't know how you didn't know, because it was in the paper and it was in the local weekly, and it was advertised all over the place. So I do hope that people will come out this time and have their say about what they want to see on the waterfront. The DeWolf Park area has been a blessing to Bedford. It's been a place where we gather often for festivals, particularly Bedford Days. We have a lot of fun down there. And my hope is that the new phase of the waterfront will provide the kind of amenities that Bedfordites will be able to enjoy. And with that, Mr. Speaker, I thank you.
The Honourable Member for Hants West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and glad to have an opportunity this afternoon to take part in the debate going into supply. And I guess this is an opportunity for us as members to talk about our constituencies and pretty much anything that we want to discuss and talk about topics that are important to our constituents and maybe recognize some people along the way and so on. But I want to start, with just saying, just take a few minutes and offer a few comments on a couple of different topics, perhaps. And one of them, as we move forward, that's important in all of our constituencies, and mine is no exception, is jobs and the economy, Mr. Speaker. And we're really focused on that as we move forward right now, given how times are around the world and certainly in this province. Times are pretty tough for people. So we think a lot about the opportunities that might come, what jobs will be created. We often have heard government talk about staying in their place here, and different members talk about the many hundreds of jobs actually that await us. Sometimes they talk about the many hundreds of jobs that have been developed, and numbers have been given so high, a number that not even that many people live in the community. So it's been interesting to hear some of that discussion. But I do want to say that jobs in the economy are very important where I come from in Hants West. I look after the town of Hantsport, the town of Windsor, and a fairly large municipal unit called the Municipality of the District West Hants. And somewhere around 19,500, 20,000 people live there, Mr. Speaker. And adults voting age, if you look at the charts and statistics, will tell you there's probably 15,000 or more. And that's probably on average, I guess, for most places, and maybe a little lower or a little higher, but it fits into the average of, I think, what most constituencies are. So when you think about that population based on the demographic and the age groups, you think about jobs and where we're going and where we've been. And like every area, not specific to rural Nova Scotia, I think it's captured everywhere. We have our demographic of seniors, and we have a fairly large number of seniors in my constituency who are very active. And they pay attention to what's going on, and they wonder what will be there. A lot of them, although we call them seniors, are quite young, both at heart and physically, and worry about what will happen to them. Not only the younger people are looking for jobs, but they're trying to survive. And a lot of these folks are surviving on very little. And when I ask them from time to time, how do you survive on that, they say, we don't survive, we exist. It's interesting. When they talk about that, you know, and they wonder where we'll be in another 7, 8, 10 years maybe, and how they're going to exist, if you will. But just as importantly and more importantly, Mr. Speaker, is the jobs that, Madam Speaker, I should say, are jobs that we're looking for. And we've lost our share of jobs in the Valley, and certainly in my constituency alone. We've seen over the last couple of years, unfortunately, the closure of Fundy Gypsum. We're hoping somewhere into the years ahead that we may see something more positive there, that there'll be a few jobs come back, and maybe at one point, I don't know how many years out, there may be a lot of jobs to be offered there once again. But that doesn't really make up for, the problem with that is it doesn't really make up for the jobs that have been lost, because those people have moved on. Some of them would have been packaged off, retired, etc., but a lot of them would have gone elsewhere to look for work. Some of them would have gone west, as we continually hear about out-migration and people seeking employment opportunities, Madam Speaker. But we've also lost 135 jobs recently in Hantsport. And for a small town like Hantsport, Madam Speaker, that is a painful reality of how things are around the world. We need to try and figure out what kind of investments will create long-term sustainable jobs, good-paying jobs where people will stay. I talked about this briefly last night in the few minutes I had during debate. We really, if we're going to focus, we have to focus on job creation throughout the province, throughout areas that have been hit very hard, and we know all throughout the valley, around Cape Breton, all over the province, as a matter of fact, we've seen certainly more, perhaps in rural Nova Scotia, we've seen thousands of jobs lost. So we need to continue to focus on job creation. One of the things that we're always excited about in Nova Scotia, and we hear a lot about, and Cape Breton has been made famous over the years, I guess, for being recognized, as when it comes to tourism and the opportunities that exist in the most beautiful places. And I don't have the documentation in front of me, but I do recall through magazines that they've been the number one island. Thank you, Ed. Number one island around, and a lot of numbers that are in the top. We do know that when it comes to Cape Breton, but it's not just Cape Breton that they come to see. It's a piece of what they come for. People come from all over the world in Nova Scotia. We get a chance to meet them, whether it's in Cape Breton or in Windsor or in Yarmouth and certainly in other areas around the province, and they come to tour our province. They come for a variety of reasons. There are people that come in summer here that live in the United States. I know a few now that share their time. Hard to believe that actually happens. It's usually us going the other way when we think about the winter Floridas or whatever people do going south for the nicer weather. And they're coming here in the summertime actually to enjoy that and take in what we have to offer. But it's a big piece of our economy. Now, we've heard discussions recently, an announcement last September, I believe it was, late August, September, about tourism opportunities and jobs, and an office being put in Windsor. And that is good as far as the folks around home are concerned. That will create some jobs. We're quite confident of that, or at least we're hopeful. We hear that there is a place now that's been put up as what will be the new place, and some work will need to be done and so on, and that will go through the processes and then be opened and I heard the other day it will now be November. Well, that's fine. Things take time to get done. But throughout what we consider the good season, nice climate weather, we have a number of tourists. We have opportunities. They go down the shore. They enjoy the festivals, like the Peterson's Bluegrass Festival down there. That's a big thing. One of the things that we have to be concerned about, though, and you know, when you try to relate this maybe to some of the budget items and how it impacts us, well, it really does, because we've seen in the last few years, unfortunately, our transportation budget and certainly our RIM dollars. And anybody who lives in rural Nova Scotia has a responsibility for fixing roads and is counted on to get some things done. And even with just patching up some roads, we don't get a whole lot of solid roads paving done and the whole stretch done. We get a little bit here and there. But, you know, if we're not maintaining those roads, and I think about the 215, over the course of years, we finally got that through all of Hants West, but it took a number of years to get done. We're doing some work down there again this year. And that's good, because we have a lot of folks with campers, and I can remember the complaints. But every time you cut that RIM budget back, and we've seen it every year, the cuts to this budget, it takes away that traffic that's going to go maybe off on one of the side roads or down through the shore or one of our beautiful places around West Hants. It doesn't take long for that tourism group to find out, no, we better not go there. We were down through there last year and things weren't so great, to divert them away. And the last thing we need to do is divert anybody away. And it's not just about driving on the roads, although that has a huge impact. It's about staying at places like our bed and breakfast that are around and helping to support them, because I can tell you, talking to those that own the bed and breakfast around my area, that there's been significant losses, the hotel rooms in our local hotel, just based on the ferry alone, the traffic not coming the other way. We have seen it's been a huge impact on all of Nova Scotia. It's been a huge impact on Southwest Nova, and that transfers. We're not that far away from Yarmouth when you think about it, a couple hours or so drive. And what used to be quite popular was people would get off the ferry, they would drive through the valley, they'd spend a little time in Yarmouth and a little time in wherever and make their way down, and by evening they'd find a place in and about our area, because that pretty much took up the day of travel. And I can tell you that those people like John Briganti, who own a bed and breakfast in town, are down considerably. And he's just one that comes to mind. I know that they all are, and as I said, the hotels are down too. But tourism is a big opportunity for us in this province that we've not taken great advantage of. I don't think it's for lack of trying. I think there's been some certainly interest. We've had tourism organizations that have now formed into other things. We talk a great talk, but it shouldn't be that hard. I think we've got a lot of things to offer, but we don't seem to invest in what we have to offer. And I realize there has to be partnerships with certainly with our municipal units as well on things like tourism. I think they have a role to play. They will all say the same thing. It's very difficult financially to try and invest money that they don't have, because there's always something else. There always seems to be something else. But we have to take advantage and incent these organizations somehow to create jobs. And not just for the summertime. You know, we also think about, I've got a lot of small business in my area. I've got a lot of medium-sized businesses that have been around for years. And thankfully, some of them are hanging on, and they'll continue to hang on, or at least I hope they will. But you know, when we think about the big expended money that's been spent on large corporations to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars, if we'd have taken just a small piece of that and went to the small business community and set some criteria. I'm not just saying throw money at it. I don't want anyone to take that the wrong way, nor would they want that. But set some criteria where they could apply or be part of and not be ruled out because of their age, as an example. I think of one business in the town of Windsor, because there were two gentlemen who retired from previous businesses that they were involved in and started a store and wanted to do some expansions and wanted to hire people. They didn't meet the criteria that was in place. And they looked at that and they took that, you know, pretty seriously. They never felt that that was right. But what if we'd have taken a small piece of that? Well, I'll get back to that. We'd taken a small piece of those big, big ticket items that we're investing in that we're really not been sure of, you know? And we said, let's go invest in the small business community in the province of Nova Scotia. They would have been thrilled. Hired one or two people in each of their stores, and the spin-off effect from that, from them working, from them being able to spend and buy, and the spin-off effect, as I said, in other stores, and it just continues growth. Higher taxes do nothing. We've learned that quite quickly. Higher taxes do nothing to instill a better economy or spending. We know that people are saying, no, wait, I won't buy that new car, or I won't buy that bigger ticket item. They won't invest in that, not with the taxes as high as they are. They have some hope that they'll come down, You know, and they're looking forward to that because it matters. When you talk a couple of percent, it doesn't sound like a lot, but when you put it on a big ticket item, it's a fair chunk of money that most people are going to say, no, I'll wait, or they'll go somewhere else. Even worse, they'll go elsewhere and they'll buy. We need people to be wanting to come to Nova Scotia. We talked yesterday about, you know, what about giving some ideas or incentives for people to come to Nova Scotia to start business. Well, that's all well and good. There should be a sign out there at the border that says, welcome to Nova Scotia. We are open for business. But let's not forget one thing. There's a lot of very intelligent entrepreneurs in this province. Statistics will show you that in the province of Nova Scotia, we have more PhDs, if you want to think about that level, per capita than anyone else in the country. A lot of people may not know that. There is a lot of very intelligent people who want to go into business. A lot of people started businesses in our neighboring provinces because of things like tax problems, spending, for a variety of reasons. We should be looking at ideas for homegrown success in all areas. We hear the statement about homegrown success in farming and some other, you know, nice little one-ofs, if you will. We're not really doing that. But the small business community is a huge driver of what goes on in this province. And we all have been great at talking about small business, small business, small business. But if you go to the small business community and you ask them what's been done for them, they'll tell you not much, as sad as that might sound. That's how they feel. And I know that they lobby steady. They've done that for years. They've done that with every government, rightfully so. But we need to do more. And they are a place, I think, that we should be focused on when it comes to trying to grow the economy and invest wisely. Like I said, I'm not just saying you throw money at it, but you put some criteria around it. Not difficult criteria, but solid criteria that makes it worthwhile. Stepping in, taking a chance, hiring people, helping to create what we need to happen here, and that is solid support for Nova Scotia. I met with, on Saturday morning, had a great opportunity to meet with the young farmers in Nova Scotia. They held their annual general meeting in Windsor, which was nice to see. Great group of young folks who want to stay in this this industry. Some might question why at times. I think they question it themselves sometimes. And, you know, they do it because they love it, and they're not long telling you that. It's not because they're getting rich or making a bunch of money. They soon tell you that as well, and I'm sure the ministers heard that on occasion from probably more than the young farmers. But, you know, and I know he's talked about, and through the estimates, we had a chance to do a little back and forth and talk about programs to incent our young people to stay on and carry on with farms, not only just to carry on the family farm, but wouldn't it be nice to see some real growth in the farming industry and some new farmers, some new land? We know that there was a report done a couple of years back that said we have all kinds of land in the province, all kinds that could be used, and instead of growing up in trees, what an opportunity it would be to invest in our farm community and our local farmers, and what would be new farmers maybe in the province, and give them some opportunities to go forward. And there's a lot of people that have been in the industry for quite a while, and I say quite a while, and they're not old. You know, they're maybe our age. Got a lot of years. Thanks, Ed. Got a lot of years left to farm as well, and they want to keep things going. I believe it is a responsibility that we need to make sure that we can still look after ourselves, that we can still feed ourselves to some degree. We don't do that well. There's a number of programs. You know, I spoke during estimates as well about the dinners and the suppers and the things that go on through Select Nova Scotia. That was a program that we started quite a few years ago. Didn't realize time went by so quickly. I wasn't planning on speaking that long, actually, Madam Speaker. So I thank you for that, and it's been a pleasure this afternoon to take a few minutes and just touch on a few topics for Hans West. Thank you.
Now recognize the Honourable Member for Lunenburg West.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker, and it gives me a great pleasure to speak for a few minutes. The debate going into supply on a number of issues that are of concern to my constituents, and they're of concern to me, and I hope they're of concern to all Nova Scotians. I've often spoken in this house about how life is contextual, and you know, John Donne, the great British poet, sort of summed that up quite succinctly when he said, in a very few words, no man is an island, and of course no man is an island, and I guess in the context of the geopolitical situation in which we find ourselves today, that truism could probably be extrapolated to mean that no country is an island either. And anybody who pays attention, I guess, knows that the The global economy and the international banking system and the world trading patterns confirm that is indeed the case. And you know, another great thinker, Madam Speaker, Santayana, offered up another truism in a very parsimonious way, just in a few words. And what he basically said was, those who forget the past are condemned to repeat it. And it is my contention that these two famous gentlemen are very helpful, really, in helping us to focus our thinking, and maybe help to focus the thinking of any credible government which intends to effect meaningful change for its citizenry. The first quote by Dunn acknowledges the fact that we are not alone, neither as individuals or as part of a collective. It recognizes that our actions affect others, that our decisions have implications for others, and depending on our vocation in life or our place in the community or our position in the family, these implications can be quite profound and significant to the life of the individual or, in the broader context, the lives of the populace. Second quote drives home why we must have good memories, long memories, and why we must be ever vigilant and learn from the mistakes of the past so as not to repeat them in the future. And in the present context in which we find ourselves, what does this mean then? What does this mean for us? Well, first of all, it means that we have to recognize that for the past 4 years, the world has been going through a very stormy economic time. And Madam Speaker, our tiny province in this great country in which we live is not immune from that storm. And we are not alone in having gone through stormy times because, and everybody knows these, I know, Greece and Portugal and Ireland and Spain, United States, virtually every other country in the world has been going through a similar period of economic turmoil. And I'm not interested in spending time this afternoon on an examination as to why these economic conditions have been visited upon us. Rather, I simply wish to acknowledge the fact that they've been visited on us and note that all provinces in our country have been affected. And as a result, the majority of the Canadian provinces have been running significant deficits. That being said, I'm very pleased that Nova Scotia is one of four Canadian provinces that's been able to balance its budget while providing expanded services for its citizens. And this is no mean feat, and it's an accomplishment that has been appreciated by my constituents and by many Nova Scotians across our province. It is a fact, however, the significance of which seems, for whatever reason, to have escaped my colleagues on the other side of the House. You know, both the Liberal Party and those in the PC Party have tried at all costs to trivialize the importance of this accomplishment. And it is a position which separates them from many of the citizens of our province. In any event, it is a fact that the budget delivered by the Minister of Finance in this House on April 4th was indeed balanced and received an unqualified opinion from the Auditor General. The first time, by the way, such an opinion on a budget in this province has been given by the Auditor General in a decade. That's also significant, in my opinion. So that is an accomplishment, and that's a significant and important accomplishment. And although both the Liberal and the PC parties would deign imply that it's a that is a good thing and would try to minimize it, it is indeed a fact. And it can't easily be discounted or dismissed. It's a fact that we have a balanced budget. And it is an important fact. And I keep saying it because I want to drive that home. So again, why would we want to minimize the importance of this accomplishment? Why would the old line party sort of be out of sync with Nova Scotians? Well, allow me to submit the following. The last time the Liberal government balanced the budget in this House was 1976. That's a long time ago, Madam Speaker. And as a matter of fact, I believe I heard the member from Hammonds Plains, Upper Sackville, mention in this House the other day that he wasn't born then. And Madam Speaker, looking at this robust, vigorous young man today, we can see that that was indeed a substantial period of time, a long time ago. Now, in the interest of time, just jumping ahead here, two decades to the 1990s, we have the Liberal Party endeavoring to balance the budget, in the most draconian of ways. I believe the medical workers, particularly nurses, as well as our hardworking and dedicated teachers, well remember the techniques employed. Madam Speaker, in the 1990s, the Liberal Party used the hardworking nurses and teachers as the lever to try to pry out a balanced budget here in Nova Scotia. And to realize this goal, they closed 1,500 hospital beds, bought out about 800 nurses' contracts, and nothing, zero, was sacred with that group then. Madam Speaker, they rolled back dental care. Check this out. They rolled back dental care for children from age 13 to 9, something I might add that this government has rectified in our recent balanced budget. And Nova Scotia teachers, I believe most of them will, remember wage freezes. I was a teacher then. Wage freezes and rollbacks and working for free. And we had a name for that at the time. We worked for free. Nova Scotians will remember a time under previous governments when you were stripped of all your possessions when you entered long-term care and you paid $600 for an ambulance ride to the hospital. In case you're keeping track, anybody's keeping track, it now costs $142.30. Far cry from $600. Madam Speaker, those were dark days. They were regressive days. They were Liberal and Tory days, and those days are over. Madam Speaker, a new dawn has arrived. Madam Speaker, in those dark times, parents who had to take a child out of province for medical care, which was unavailable here in Nova Scotia, they had to find their own money for travel and accommodation. Now, this created a huge hardship for many families, and I'm very pleased to report, Madam Speaker, that we changed this. I can further report, Madam Speaker, that there is a family in Lunenburg West living in my constituency, and in particular a lovely little girl who was very, very pleased that we made that change. Very, very pleased indeed. The opposition Liberals have spent a lot of time in this House talking about insulin pumps. Insulin pumps for children, and this is an important health care innovation for folks with type 1 diabetes. A fact which does not escape me because of family circumstances. Madam Speaker, the Minister of Health and all my colleagues on this side of the House are aware of how important insulin pumps can be in stabilizing and controlling the delivery of insulin to diabetics. But, Madam Speaker, while the Liberals talk a good game on this issue, it is our government that made this come to pass. Madam Speaker, there's talk and there's action. And I'm pleased, as are my constituents and all folks across our province, that we have been able to offer this significant health benefit to our citizens. Madam Speaker, it takes money to deliver services. The former finance minister was often quoted as saying, and I think this is pretty much exactly what he said, if you want to talk to me about taxes, in the same conversation, you have to talk to me about services. And that's because, as we all know, taxes pay for services. That's it, Madam Speaker. It takes money to deliver these services. Nova Scotians know this, at least the ones that I talk to. They also know about the fiscal situation that pertains in the world, to which I alluded earlier. And they also know about the lamentable situation we inherited when we came into office. And they know that we're not immune to either of those things. Now, Madam Speaker, our citizenry has played a major part in helping us get back to balance, so that we can all do the things we need to do to make life better for Nova Scotians, like taking the HST off home heating and electricity, like taking the HST off children's clothing and footwear and feminine hygiene products, and like putting into place all the health care supports mentioned earlier. Madam Speaker, getting back to balance helped us on a number of other fronts too. It allowed us to increase ESIA payments by 22%, put in place the affordability tax credit for folks making less than $30,000, and the poverty reduction tax credit for people making less than $15,000. And, Madam Speaker, it's why we have taken over 20,000 seniors off the provincial income tax rolls, making life easier for a most valuable sector of our population. Those are the people that helped build Nova Scotia and make it what it is today. Madam Speaker, that's what a government that has compassion does, and that's what a government with foresight does, and that's what a government with a plan does. And, Madam Speaker, Nova Scotians get that. They really do. It's not It's not our style, not at all, to freeze wages, to roll back wages, to kill off collective agreements, create toll highways, close hospital beds, lay off nurses, punish teachers, build P3 schools, or borrow huge sums of money to pay down the debt. Madam Speaker, in the 2009 platform put forth by the Liberal Party, there was over $527 million worth of promises, but no explanation as to how this would be paid for. I believe that's the, I think most Nova Scotians know that as the fiasco called what happened to page 34. Madam Speaker, that page could not be found. That page could not be found. The money could not be found. And fortunately for all Nova Scotians, the votes could not be found, so Nova Scotians didn't have to bear the burden of a government that was bereft of ideas and which had no notion of how to move us forward. Madam Speaker, we have been told by Nova Scotians that they want to see us develop the rural economy. They don't want everything to be Halifax-centric. Madam Speaker, we agree. That's why we have embarked on a strategy to decentralize and move government departments to the regions. This is why we have relocated agriculture to the Truro Bible Hill area, fisheries to Digby, aquaculture to Shelburne, tourism to Windsor, and the maintenance enforcement sector of the Department of Justice to New Waterford. Madam Speaker, we were opposed and criticized by the opposition for doing that with these institutions departments. And similarly, we have been criticized by the opposition for keeping decisions made about health care in the regions. Both opposition parties want to see the elimination of regional DHAs. And this is in spite of the fact that other jurisdictions have shown that this is not a move which saves money. It does result, though, in taking decisions on health care away from local boards who really understand the problems best and concentrates that decision-making in a place like Halifax. Madam Speaker, that's a bad idea, and that's not going to be something that we're going to be doing. Now, Madam Speaker, when we were elected in 2009, folks voted for a change. They wanted to see an end to stagnation. They wanted to eliminate the old swinging pendulum, you know, between the two old-style parties. I'm pleased to say, Madam Speaker, that Nova Scotians accomplished this. Both opposition parties in this House have opposed economic growth and good jobs. They criticize support for Port Hawkesbury, workers in Queens and Lunenburg County, my area, against the jobs from projects, against the Analytics Center, the IBM jobs, even criticizing the shipbuilding contract. Hard to believe, but they did. Very, 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 very shameful, in my opinion. So we're not that group. We're quite different. It boggles my mind why this happened. Now, the leader of the third party, he's an accountant and a consultant by his own admission. I don't know if he's a fancy pants consultant, but he's a consultant. His gem's a wisdom on how we should manage the economy are reduce taxes and cut government spending. That's an old chestnut, been tried, been there, done that, doesn't work. And that's obviously not the way to move forward. All Nova Scotians, Madam Speaker, have been part of making this work. Nova Scotians have been part of making our plan work. We're proud of all Nova Scotians. We thank Nova Scotians for believing in the dream of a new day, turning the corner. And Madam Speaker, working together with all Nova Scotians, we will make our province a leader, not a follower, in the Canadian mosaic. Thank you very much.
The motion is carried. We will now take a brief recess to set up for Committee of the Whole House on Supply. Committee of the Whole House on Supply will now come to order. Recognize the Honourable Member, sorry, the Honourable Government House Leader.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, would you please call the estimates for E15?
Now call resolution E15. Recognize the Honourable Member for Kings West for the, with 5 minutes left for the official opposition.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. And with just such a short time left, I guess I will ask a question around one of the, frequent calls that will come to our office. And I'm also hearing from a number of my rural MLA colleagues. And the minister probably knows where I'm going with this, but we no longer have the vigilance nor the same enforcement level around OHV presence, infractions, and so forth on our trails. And I'm wondering, Mr. Minister, you know, who can we really call on now, and who can Nova Scotians call on when they have a need to deal with OHVs that are in fact beyond problematic and in fact are really committing infractions. We had put in place a system that by many measures, and I would get annual reports around the number of people stopped, number of infractions and fines and so on, and I'm wondering how the minister, his government, is assessing the OHV implementation of the regulations.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I'm pleased once again to have the opportunity here to talk about the estimates within the Department of Natural Resources, and I welcome the member back again, even if only for a few short minutes. And again, I'm pleased to introduce my deputy, Duff Montgomery, here on my left, our deputy minister, and Remy McDonnell from our Corporate Services Unit for Finance on my right. And off-highway vehicle, issues have been an important issue here in the department for a number of years, and certainly reached a pinnacle short years ago. And but there seems to be now a very good working relationship between the government, between the department, and the users. Both the ATV Association Nova Scotia and the Snowmobile Association Nova Scotia and other off-highway vehicle users are well organized now, and we have the off-highway vehicle infrastructure fund that shared between those three groups I just mentioned, and they work collaboratively with our department and funding, as you know, through the it's a $40 registration fee that's on many of those vehicles is accumulated and then is distributed on a proportional basis to the various groups for trails and bridges and education program. So we're, I think there's a very good working relationship there. As far as enforcement, certainly, as you know, there one time had been 12 dedicated enforcement officers assigned to police the trails out there. But today we actually have all our conservation officers are fully trained and available and can, and in conjunction with the RCMP and sometimes municipal police forces, work together to ensure that there's not violations or danger out there to the public. So I'd say overall the system is working very well. It's funded by the $40 fee for improvements, and there's generally a pretty good air of cooperation.
Recognize the Honourable Member for Kings West with 30 seconds remaining.
Just then, very quickly, one of the other calls that I've had from a number of people are those that will purchase an OHV with just a month or two remaining in the year, but yet they have to pay that full fee. I'm wondering if, in fact, there is any thinking about doing a prorated basis for a three-month period, for example.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
I know our time's just about out, and maybe we'll have to continue our conversation in the next round, so to speak, but I will take that under advisement and see if that is being considered or if it may be a possibility.
The time allotted for the official opposition has expired. I will now recognize the Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and I want to thank the Minister for the opportunity to do some estimates and welcome his staff here today. I look forward to asking some questions and hopefully getting some answers, direct answers. And we're going to start with last year, the provincial park in Indian Brook, or known as Bereswa, in Victoria County, was permanently closed because of some issues with sinkholes and there were some safety concerns. And at a public meeting there, attended by the DNR staff, residents were told that they would conduct a search to see if there might be Crown land in close proximity that they could be used as a provincial park site. And I'm just wondering if the minister could let us know where they are in that stage, because that park was a highlight for a lot of the people in the community, and they're looking for a new green space to use and to access. So if the minister can comment as to whether any progress has been made on this issue or not, it would be appreciated.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. And I know the Honourable Member is from beautiful Cape Breton. And the other day I had some geographical challenges on trying to straighten out between Manadou and Gabarus, and so I've brought a map along with me, Madam Chair, of Cape Breton Island, just to make sure we're on the same page here. And I've found places like Scattery Island, where the MV Minor is resting, and Gabarus Seawall. I'm sure these issues may come up. The Donkin Mine, but and I even found beautiful Big Pond, where unfortunately our songsters from Cape Breton, Rita McNeil, had been from. So I'm familiar with those areas. But I'm trying to find Bereswa on my map. And I believe is the area that, does the park have another name? Plaster Rock, that's the name I'm looking for. Okay, well then I'm familiar with the situation there. And obviously there was some sinkhole problems there where they decided for public safety reasons to close that park last year, and I believe the Honourable Member from Victoria of the Lakes had attended some of the sessions with the department, and I think actually there was a public meeting held in the community with the local MLA and with the DNR staff, and explained the safety issue. So that particular park has been closed for that reason. And I know the municipal council there too is working to see what might be possible for other possible locations. In addition, we have our parks review and our protected areas review, and I know they're looking at additional lands in that general area that might be considered for a public recreation or public walking or hiking, and bird watching, whatever people enjoy doing. So I would say there are discussions with the municipality and through the parks and protected area review process, and we're hoping that there can be an area found that's not too far from Plaster Rock in that community that can serve that that role as for public recreation or for the public to go out and stroll and to enjoy the great outdoors.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Well, thank you very much, Madam Chair. And Minister, it's been over a year since that park was closed, and it is my understanding that the municipality of Victoria has offered up some land to maybe replace that facility. And the people have been quite patient, which Cape Bretoners usually are. And the question is really, now that a year or more has elapsed, and there has been an offer, as I understand it, from Victoria County, I wonder if the minister would give us a timeline as to how they might be able to act on this situation so that the people will once again have a provincial park in their community.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. And I do know that just this week that we had a meeting with the Municipal Council, or with at least the warden and at least one councillor from the municipality. And I know the local MLA was able to attend that, along with staff from the Department of Natural Resources. And I know that suggestion, or that proposal, I should say, came forward from the council. So it's being looked at, it's being considered, but it was just 2 days ago, I think it was yesterday, actually, that they met here at the House. And so that's an offer that's been, it's under consideration, it's being looked at, and we as much as residents of the area want to find a solution here, that people will have an area they can go and enjoy the enjoy nature. And but you know, as you know, the provincial park that was there is just not safe anymore. It's just not. It's a public hazard, and was agreed by all that was the case. So we're as anxious as anyone to find a solution, and we'll continue to work with council, and we'll continue to roll through our parks and protected areas plan. And there's still input being taken in on that plan, and but hopefully sometime this year we'll have a workable solution for the community there in Victoria County.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Well, thank you very much, Madam Chair, and I want to thank the Minister for that answer. And I would encourage that now that there's a possible solution on the horizon, I would ask that they would try to move it along, because, as I say, it has been over a year now, and I think, in fairness to the people of the area, that would be the right move to make. And I understand that there's lots of challenges, but at the same time, it would be something that would be appreciated. I was wondering if the minister could give me an update on what's taking place with the biomass plant in Port Hawkesbury.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Certainly, this will cross over into the Department of Energy as well, but I happen to know the Minister there quite well as also. So, my understanding, the plant is scheduled to open sometime this summer. We're in the final stages of getting there. It's part of our renewable electricity plan to have, co-generated facility there at Port Hawkesbury, and by early summer it should be up and operating. Of course, that's going to produce electricity as well as steam for the pulp mill, and it's part of our co-generation facility under renewable electricity. And also, we've been getting ready for this. There's under the Forestry Infrastructure Fund that was established when that mill was down, the pulp mill. There's been contractors and woods workers actively involved in the forest industry, and the low volume or low end product is what's suitable for biomass, and that's been stored. And there's a large volume of material there that's ready that will be sold by the province to the operator, to Nova Scotia Power, and that will create, generate some additional income for the province. But there's a large storage amount there that's available, and there's contractors in the RFP that have been identified to supply the product. And so, within the next couple months, we should see that facility up and running.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Can the Minister give us an explanation as to a definition as to what biomass is?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. Well, biomass is any material that, it can come from forest products, it can come from farm products, it can be you know, any living material that's suitable for, you know, for this type of operation. It can be burned to produce energy. And I know there's a lot of research and work being done around the world and on biomass growth, certainly here, even here in Nova Scotia. There's, I believe in Cape Breton, there's some research being done on willow or a switchgrass that's fast growing that can be harvested on about a 3-year cycle and that, you know, is suitable for biomass. There's a number of farmers around the province that are interested in growing miscanthus, which is a crop that can be harvested annually on land, and once it's there, it's established for decades, and you know, it can be harvested every year. I know there's farmers in Annapolis County and in Pictou County and well beyond that are experimenting with that crop right now and see how it can be best produced. But of course, the main source that's been identified is from forest waste, or the secondary product that's you know, as a result of harvesting of you know, other more valuable species. And I guess biomass from in the forest aspect is really you know, what's not suitable for good logs, for hardwood or softwood. It can be you know, during selection harvesting, for example, and the operator goes in and takes out some of the better logs, but also he may want to take out some of the less valuable stuff so that other trees can grow. So if you've got a 6-inch diameter tree, it's not ready to harvest, but it might be thinned out around it. So that waste wood, so-called, it could be stems that are crooked or stems that are diseased or just too crowded, too tight. They're not going to grow into a good quality tree or a good quality log. So those are the thinnings, more or less, that are taken out of the woodlot. And yes, it can be used for firewood, but it can be used for the ship to the biomass plant as well. So biomass really can come from a variety of sources, the farm, the woodlot, the you know, wood waste, maybe sawdust or hog fuel or you know, the bark off of trees and so on. So there's a variety of product can go into the biomass plant.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Madam Chair, and through you to the Minister, could the Minister give us an indication of the amount of biomass that's going to be required by the Pine Tupper plant and the proposed plant in the Harbourside Commercial Park in Sydney?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And certainly overall, as a province, we have an amount that's been identified, you know, for forest use. Now, that doesn't count, you know, farm waste or farm crops that are produced for this purpose. But on our forestry side, we're being cautious, and we don't want to over-harvest our woodlands. On the other hand, it's an opportunity to thin out the woods and make them better, you know, so they can improve and grow better for future crops. But that amount had been initially identified as 500,000 dry tons province-wide. And again, erring on the side of caution to make sure that we don't over-harvest our lands. That was reduced, I believe, about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. It was set at 350,000 dry tons. And so that's the total available or that can be used in the province for biomass production. And I don't have the exact figures here for the Sydney project or the Port Hawkesbury project, but I'll endeavor to get those. I have an idea what they are, but I don't want to give you wrong information, so let me get the total tonnage that should be used in each of those facilities. When I have it, I'll pass it on to you.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I wonder, through you to the Minister, if I could ask what the approximate price a forester could expect for biomass.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. And of course, prices are something that our woodlot owners are always interested in. You know, naturally, they want to get as high price as they can get. I'm a woodlot owner myself, and if I have some hardwood logs harvested, or softwood, pulpwood, or studwood, or whatever, naturally, I want you know, as high as the price you can get at roadside. But market forces determine, you know, really where that's going to end up. But in the case of biomass, it's again, the principle of that we operate under is the highest and best use for the forest, and it makes every economic sense that you know, you'll get your good quality hardwood logs or softwood logs that you'll get the most money out of, and then comes down to studwood and down to pulpwood and maybe firewood, and then biomass. But again, often the biomass is the net result of good forest management, and you're not going in to cut every tree, you know, for biomass. It's the leftovers. It's the waste. It actually is the opportunity to improve your woodlot and let other good trees grow. And by cutting out the thinnings, the damaged or diseased stems, that's what goes to biomass. It's the least valuable product in the woodlot. But if I remember correctly, it's somewhere around the $35 a ton, I think, is the going price for biomass.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Very much, Madam Chair. Minister, currently in the Port Hawkesbury paper area, the agreement, which was used to be known as the store agreement, I believe it was, for the land, the Crown lands around it, and about a year or year and a half ago, when there was changes made with the challenges that were met at that plant, there were some talks about changing away the way that the leases were provided. I wonder if you could give me an update as to just how the leases are in relation to Port Hawkesbury paper now, and also what effect that would have on the smaller contractors who do hardwood flooring and other things of that nature, the value-added products that come out of the forestry.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair, and the Honourable Member is correct in that we have changed the way we do forestry agreements, and we've changed the way we do forestry practices in this province. And under the old agreement, which the Stora Act controlled, I think was signed in the late 1950s, I think, when the Swedish company came to Port Hawkesbury, and it was known as the Stora Act, and it was a good act at the time for that period in our history, but you know, today in more modern times, there's much more interest in good forest management, and we've adapted and changed to that. And so the Stora Act has been repealed, and we've replaced it now with the Forestry Utilization Licensing Agreement. The Stora Act had been for 50 years, and the new agreement is for 20 years. And in reality, it gives us much more control of our own resources. It gives us much more control of our destiny. And it allows us to, you know, have the say in how the forest is operated. You know, we've insisted on FSC certification on those lands, and the Stern Group, Port Hawkesbury Paper now as it's called, is very much is complying with that. You know, there's a role now for Mi'kmaq consultation that was not there before. The roads that are on the Crown lands are, you know, owned by the province, and we have a say on how they're opened up to the public for hunting or fishing or, you know, recreational use in a responsible way. Before, those lands were like private lands of a corporation, and you know, they controlled how the use was looked after. In addition, you know, the agreement under the Forestry Utilization Licensing Agreement indicates that, you know, a certain portion of the wood has to be purchased from private woodlot owners, in addition to the Crown land that they have to responsibly manage. So the agreement was 400,000 tons that would be harvested from Crown land and 200,000 tons from private land. So that's about a third would come from private lands. However, you know, the companies got off to a good start, and they've got a good working relationship in the community, and they've actually been buying almost half of their wood from private woodlot owners. And I understand there's actually more private contractors and woods workers involved with the Port Hawke's Bay paper now than under the previous company. So that's a good thing. You know, there's more private woodlot owners engaged, more private contractors, more truckers and others servicing the forest industry there than ever before in eastern Nova Scotia. So it's a good working relationship, and I think, again, under the Forestry Utilization Licensing Agreement, we have a much better control over how the forest land is managed, and you know, forestry has a future in this province, and certainly Port Hawke's Bay paper is committed to that, and it's great to see 1,400 families, 1,400 workers there employed again, and so it's, as they say, it's onward and upward from here. So we're very positive about the outcome there and the future moving forward.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The Minister talks about 1,400 jobs that were created, saved. I wonder if you could give us an indication of just where those jobs are located, because there's less people working at the mill. There appears to be less people producing wood, at least in Cape Breton County. And you mentioned that about more than half of the wood supply for Port Hawkesbury paper is coming from private woodlands. I wonder if the minister knows the geographical location of those woodlands, because in conversation with contractors in my own community and others around Cape Breton Island, they tell me that they haven't been selling any wood to the people in Port Hawkesbury because, quite frankly, they can't afford to. So I wonder if the minister can tell us that all this wood that's coming from private land, firstly, is it coming from Nova Scotian private land? And secondly, what areas that it is coming from? And then I would be very interested in a breakdown on the 1,400 jobs that have been mentioned in this House on numerous occasions.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. And certainly it is great to see the economy of the Strait region reinvigorated again and having people back to work. You know, the 1,400 jobs are in the mill itself, in the woodlands, and contractors and truckers and silvicultural contractors. I don't have a breakdown for each of those categories, but it's all those are involved directly with the mill, and I guess indirectly through sawmills and others that are integrated into the supply chain. You know, like Williams Brothers in Barney's River in eastern Pictou County, or Rivers Bend Hardwood Mill in Anakinish County, Finewood Flooring in Victoria County, B.A. Fraser in Cape Breton, and M.R. McDonald, I know, is a hardwood mill also in Pictou County. So there's a strong integration there in the forestry industry, but it's truckers, it's contractors, it's employees directly employed with those individuals. It's actual direct workers at the mill. You know, certainly also there's indirect jobs that, you know, right from the local hairdresser to the barber to the Canadian Tire to, you know, the people have money, they're spending it, they're able to stay here in Nova Scotia and support their families. And so, you know, people spend their money when they're living here. And so it's, people go on vacation. They go to bed and breakfasts. They go anywhere, you know, elsewhere in the province. So it's hard to measure, but economic impact is huge. Actually, in the 6 months that the company's been operating, they've spent more than $80 million in the local economy, you know, buying the goods and services. So that's a huge economic, that's in 6 months. So in a year, I expect that to be $160 million. So it's having a significant impact on the economy in the southern eastern counties from Pictou, Anakinish, Guysborough, Victoria, Inverness, Richmond, and Cape Breton County. So it's all positive. You asked in particular some of the contractors or where the wood's coming from. I know Bedeck Valley Wood Producers Co-op is, I believe it's Mike Gillis is involved there in managing that co-op, and so some of it's certainly coming out of that region. Cliff Sangster in northern Inverness County is producing a significant amount of wood for the mill. I know Neil Kenny in Pictou County is another producer that's supplying product from private land primarily, yes, entirely in his case. So it's a variety. Some are working on crown land, some are working on private lands, but you mentioned the figure there. Maybe I didn't give you the exact figure. It was 48% of their wood is coming from private lands at this time.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
48% is coming from private land. And the question was, is that land all in Nova Scotia? Is that private wood all coming from Nova Scotia? Is one question. And the other question, you talk about the economic impact that the mill has had, and I don't doubt that there is an impact. But if you were to talk to some of the merchants in the area of Port Hawkesbury, they would tell you that their business has actually gone down, not gone up, that they haven't recovered from when the plant originally closed. And if you're going to invest $128 million plus and come up with a number of 1,400 jobs, I believe that the people of the province of Nova Scotia deserve to know how that number was derived at. Because if you could say that there was 1,400 jobs, and by the way, in question period here one day, we had the Minister of Rural and Economic Development say there were 1,400 jobs, and we had the Premier say there was 1,000 jobs in the same question period. So if you're investing that kind of money of the taxpayers of the province of Nova Scotia, I think it's only reasonable to believe that you have an understanding of exactly where those jobs have been created, how they've been created, and how the investment made by the province of Nova Scotia is affecting them. So is it 1,000 jobs? Is it 1,400 jobs? And are the jobs directly related? Quite honestly, Mr. Minister, people going away on vacation probably doesn't add a whole lot of money to the economy of Nova Scotia because they're going away, in your words. So I'm just curious, with that kind of investment, do you really understand what jobs were created? And again, going back to what the minister and the premier have said and disagreeing in the amount of jobs, I'd be just curious to see how you can invest that kind of money and not really know where the jobs are at.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. And certainly, you know, the fact that the mill is up and running again and, you know, is providing good wages directly at the mill and certainly in the woodlots and through contractors and truckers and silviculture workers, my understanding that, you know, those jobs are certainly important to the regional economy and 1,400 is the figure that I stand by. And those are jobs that were kept alive, kept going through the Forestry Infrastructure Fund. You know, the Premier announced almost immediately after the mill shut down, he traveled to Port Hawkesbury and met with the workers and with the local businesses in the area and said, we're committed. And he had a 7-point plan that would allow for the industry to stay alive, and there was woods contractors and truckers and silviculture workers that were all kept going, and a lot of that wood was stockpiled, and the stockpile is still there for the biomass plant, and I think there's about $5 million worth of product that will be sold to the biomass plant when it gets operating this summer. So that'll be revenue coming back to the province. And there's already been a large amount of products been sold to the industry. But the most important, we kept the jobs alive. We kept them there in eastern Nova Scotia. People were able to get up and still go to work. The mill was kept in hot idle. The woods workers were actively engaged in their industry. And until the search was successful in finding a buyer, in this case it was the Stern Group that through the process was determined to be the best match for that particular mill. And today they're up and running and doing very, very well. And as I said, they've pumped more than $80 million into the economy of the Strait region and in the rest of the counties surrounding it. And they're on FSC certification. They have a very strong commitment to good forestry management. They're engaged with a number of softwood sawmills and hardwood sawmills in the area. So they're helping to create good economic activity in the eastern region. And you know, I have every confidence they're going to be successful there for many years to come. And but most important, those jobs are maintained. They're still there, and they're continue to provide for their families. And they don't have to go west to work. They don't have to travel to Ontario or wherever. They're staying right here in Nova Scotia, providing good jobs for their families and the spin-off into the local economy. Just as one example, I remember being down in Port Hawkesbury about a couple of weeks after the mill got up and running last September. And there was an operator there that owns a small business, I think it was a home hardware store, and he mentioned that during the year that the mill was in hot idle but not actually operating, he sells garage packages, you know, build your own kit and put it up yourself. And during that year, he had sold one kit from his store there, from the hardware store. But on the day that this announcement was made, he actually sold three kits on that one day. So people had confidence in the ability of that mill to really be the anchor, the cornerstone of the local economy. So I think people are very positive there now in that region, and they're looking forward to a good future.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And Minister, I think you should go back and talk to that hardware dealer and get the update as to where things are. Mr. Minister, the question that I asked on twice now, and I'll ask the third time, and this time I wouldn't muddy it with other questions around it, is all the wood that's being used in Pine Tupper coming from the province of Nova Scotia?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and certainly as I indicated, there's you know, a strong commitment to good forestry management in the seven eastern counties where the Crown arrangement is with the Port Hawkesbury Paper, and so about 52% of the wood that's available is coming from Crown land, and 48% is coming from private sources. The vast bulk of that is from Nova Scotia, absolutely. I understand there's a very small amount that is coming from New Brunswick, but for sure, the vast majority of that is from Nova Scotia woodlands.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Can the Minister confirm that when wood is brought in from New Brunswick, that there is no money from that source allocated towards silviculture? Because every time there's a Nova Scotia lumber wood is bought, there's money put into the silviculture fund. If that product is coming from out of the province, then is it indeed true that they're not adding to our silviculture fund?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. And certainly silviculture is an investment in the forestry of the future, and it's important that you know, we do the proper practices to make sure a crop is growing again and is replanted, or if pre-commercial thinning or other practices that are required. But my understanding is that the silviculture, you know, really is tied to the land, and you know, if wood is cut, then there's an obligation towards under the registered buyers program to put that money back into good silviculture, either in financial terms or in actual work to be done. And some choose to do their own work, and some choose to pay into the fund. And but you know, so if you cut 40 acres on your land, then the buyer of that wood is obligated to ensure that it's properly managed under silvicultural practices. And he can either arrange with a contractor to do it himself, or he can put money into the fund to, you know, to someone else will do it. That, you know, the people that are in the business, they go to the buyers and say, you know, I'm available, I'm an experienced crew, and I can do the work. So so that's my understanding of the way the system works.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Mr. Minister, through you, of course, Madam Chair, could you tell me if now the way that the lands are administrated, if a company like Finewood Flooring wants to be able to produce its own hardwood logs, do they deal directly with the province of Nova Scotia, or do they still have to deal with the paper mill?
Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And certainly Finewood Flooring is a good example of a local industry that puts an important emphasis on value added. And I've been to that facility in Middle River in Victoria County. And the Cristiano family, of course, is the owners of that business. And, you know, they export their product around the world, but they also sell it locally. And I know folks that have bought nice, good quality flooring from them to have in their living room. And, of course, they are a private business, and they buy their supply wherever they can. And certainly they buy from a lot of private woodlot owners. They you know, they, I believe they have some of their own lands as well, but they buy from private sources, you know, private woodlot owners. Many of the hardwood mills now have an arrangement that they deal with Port Hawkesbury paper through an agreement, and some of those mills have an agreement. I think Finewood Flooring actually has an agreement through B.A. Fraser, and they get most of their material that the raw material from through B.A. Fraser, but on the other side, B.A. Fraser has a working agreement with Port Hawkesbury Paper, as does Murray McDonald and others that are working towards that. So some have signed an agreement, some have not, but I think either they're buying from private sources or they're buying most of their stock through B.A. Fraser.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
I wonder if the Minister could tell us if all the agreements have been signed. You took great length to tell us, of course, that we have more control over our land now because of the new process that had been brought in by yourself. So the question, of course, is if we have more control, you must know, again, if the agreements have been signed and if the ability for value added is still there for the smaller businesses who didn't get the benefit of $128 million, as did the paper mill.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and certainly I do know that Port Hawkesbury Paper is fully committed to Nova Scotia. They're fully committed to environmental standards and good forestry practices under FSC certification. And actually, under the Forestry Utilization License Agreement, there's certain parameters that they, you know, they have to follow, have to live under. And but generally speaking, they're trying to work cooperatively with the other players in the supply chain, and those are softwood mills and hardwood mills. I think it was late last fall we announced that there was a couple of hardwood mills that had a working arrangement with Port Hawkesbury Paper, and they've signed an agreement on a supply. You know, logs going one way and chips or hog fuel going the other, and it's a working arrangement that they were both parties were happy with. So that was Murray McDonald, M.R. McDonald in Pictou County, and B.A. Frazier in Cape Breton. And so that was a good start. There's been ongoing negotiations, I know, with Group Savoie, and I understand they're very close to a working arrangement in that case. The Unimaki First Nations group in Cape Breton as well, they've been working with. So they're working very hard. You know, it's only a few months they've been up and operating, but they feel that the best way is to work together and find that advantages for both companies is workable. And so they're off to a good start, and they're going to continue to work with each other for the benefit of both parties.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. It's our understanding that the cost of stumpage on Crown land has doubled for pallet logs, and it has tripled for firewood. I wonder if the Minister could confirm or deny if that's correct. And if it has doubled, if you could give us a reason why it has.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And every year, the Department of Natural Resources looks at the market, looks at what private wood sales are going for, and looks at our neighbouring provinces to see what's happening there, because we're sort of integrated in a maritime market here in many ways. And after careful research, Department sets the stumpage rates, and then those are made available to all the buyers and all the mills in the province. And some years some things go up, and some years they go down, and dependent on market conditions. I understood that pallet wood actually did go up last year. I guess there was an interim setting of the rates there last October, I believe it was, and but again, about April 1st is the normal time that we set the rates. So I think some of those rates on pallet wood in particular have gone down somewhat. But again, it fluctuates up and down according to market conditions. Very high quality hardwood logs are quite valuable, and those are stumpage rates are up. On the low end. They went up last fall, and they've come down somewhat this spring.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It is our understanding that indeed pallet logs has doubled and firewood has tripled. And we're also been told that the reason for that, given by your department, Mr. Minister, was so that they would harmonize with prices that were in New Brunswick. Now, obviously, that doesn't make much sense for somebody that's trying to do work here in the province of Nova Scotia. And when you consider that power rates have not been harmonized with New Brunswick, workers' compensation rates have not been harmonized with New Brunswick, and wage rates have not been harmonized with New Brunswick, how can your department justify putting the cost of these materials at the same price as those of New Brunswick?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. And certainly, as I mentioned, stumpage rates go up and down according to market conditions, and certainly we're not immune from what happens in New Brunswick. There's supply that goes back and forth across the border both ways. As I mentioned earlier, Port Hawkesbury Paper was buying a little bit of product from that province. And so we're really in the same market here in many ways. And some of the mills operate in the province or in both provinces. A Group Savoie would be one that comes to mind. And but the important thing is that we've got to make sure that it's fair. It's got to be fair to the woodlot owner. It's got to be fair to the to the mills that are buying, and in comparison to the private rate, and it can't be out of sync too much from what the private woodlot owner is getting or what the private mill is willing to pay. And we also got to keep in mind the softwood lumber agreement in the United States, and The last thing we want to do is to cause any difficulty in that regard for our mills here in this province. So, and I guess it's got to be fair to the, to all of us as taxpayers or as owners of that Crown land. You know, you and I and 940,000 other Nova Scotians own that property. So it's got to be fair to all parties. So, and that's always what we try to do to make sure it's not too high, but make sure it's not too low. It's got to be fair to all parties.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Well, thank you very much, Madam Chair. So, has the price gone up? Has it been harmonized with New Brunswick? And how does that benefit the people of Nova Scotia who own that product if we're matching our prices to New Brunswick and we're selling the wood here in Nova Scotia? You say that there's not much wood coming from New Brunswick, and it shouldn't matter how much wood is coming from New Brunswick, because this is Nova Scotia, and you and your government have invested a lot of money in Nova Scotia in the forestry industry. So why would there be that price discrepancy in something that's inside our own province?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, again, Madam Chair, I'm not sure if there is a price discrepancy between our province and their sister province of New Brunswick. I will have to endeavour to get you those rates. I don't have them here on the tip of my finger, but I will get you the rates. I do know that pallet wood has gone down this spring, as you initially asked, but again, it's about fairness to all parties involved, and every year the rate is set, depending on market conditions that private woodlot owners are receiving, and it has to be comparable to that. Again, there's an interplay here between New Brunswick and Nova Scotia. We're really in the same market in many respects, there has to be somewhat comparable for sure. You know, if you live in Cumberland County, or if you live in Sackville, New Brunswick, you know, you're very much in the same market. And with modern trucking, truck drivers are shipping wood across the border in both directions, and so really, Nova Scotia and New Brunswick are integrated in the same market here.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. So I understand you to say that the prices are comparable in New Brunswick and in Nova Scotia. We've been told by very good sources that hardwood chips in New Brunswick are $60 a ton roadside, and in Nova Scotia, they're $32 a ton roadside. In New Brunswick, they're almost double the price that they're getting for it. So how does that benefit Nova Scotia, and how does that relate back to your theory that the prices have to be comparable?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Well, again, Madam Chair, I'll endeavour to get the stumpage rates for you. Again, I don't have them here with me, but I'll make sure you get those. And I do know that, stumpage rates is one of the factors of the cost of getting supply. But, you know, there's also the arrangements around silviculture that sometimes figure into a stumpage rate. Chips as well. I'll also make sure we get that price for you. But the administration of the program, and it can vary from province to province. We're not... you can compare apples and oranges, but you need to take into consideration all the factors that go into the cost of raw material coming to the mill. So again, I'll endeavour to get those I'll get those prices for you.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. And we're going to change gears a little while, so I don't want to irritate you too much before I ask you this question, Mr. Minister. But the minister is very aware of the Two Rivers Wildlife Park, and in one visit that he and his caucus made to Cape Breton, he was kind enough to come out and visit the Two Rivers Wildlife Park, and I appreciate him taking the time to do that because I know his time is very busy. The Two Rivers Wildlife Park, as the minister knows, is the only wildlife park on Cape Breton Island, and it used to be run by the province of Nova Scotia, and now is run by a society. Last year, they had about 4,300 visitors show up. There had been an agreement in place for core funding of $80,000 a year for 6 years. That funding is coming to a close. On February the 6th, 2012, there was a letter sent to the Honourable Minister asking for that to be extended by 3 years, and I can table that information if the Minister needs to have a look at it again. In response to that, later on, the Minister said they would review things. I guess my question is, has the department decided whether or not the Two Rivers Wildlife Park will be getting core funding extended for 3 years as a request in the letter to you?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And yes, I recall the day I had the opportunity to travel with the Honourable Member, and we did visit the Two River Wildlife Park, and I think it was a winter day, but it was the sun was out, and it was a great day to see the animals in their winter coats. And well, the park wasn't officially open, I don't believe, at the time, but we did have the opportunity to see some of the animals that reside there, and I think we met with the board of directors, and it was a good day. And I recognize that the park is well used by many, not only from Cape Breton, but visitors that come into our province from elsewhere. And if I remember correctly, I think there's even weddings have been held there and other special events from time to time. So it's a great community facility for that area of Cape Breton. I do know that the original agreement that was contracted, was assigned, was the eventual understanding was that the park would become self-sufficient after, I think, 6 years, I believe it was, and as the Honourable Member just indicated, that time period has elapsed. And but nonetheless, we recognize the importance of the park, and I do understand there's still ongoing discussions with the managers of that facility, with our staff here in DNR, and I guess the best I can say at this point is that we're engaged in discussions, and those discussions are ongoing.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
The Minister is quite correct about weddings taking place there. My oldest daughter got married at the Two Rivers Wildlife Park, so I've got some fond memories of that as well. However, the Two Rivers Wildlife Park employs about 10 individuals, and it is, Mr. Minister, it's open year-round. So, because the animals have to be fed, so they keep the facility open year-round. And it's interesting because the province of Nova Scotia actually owns the animals, and they own the infrastructure there, the buildings and that. The ask is $80,000. $80,000 helps maintain 10 jobs in rural Nova Scotia at a facility that belongs to the province of Nova Scotia, the taxpayers, but at the same token, is run by a society of committed individuals. We've seen many dollars handed out to many different groups to create employment. This group is looking for $80,000 to maintain 10 jobs on the site. And of course, if them jobs disappear and if the society has to close the park, the province would then be responsible for looking and maintaining for the animals and looking in after and maintaining the facility. So in what my kids would say is a no-brainer, extending this by 3 years, and they've already explained in the letter the different things they're doing to try to bring themselves to be into self-sufficiency, I wonder if the minister could explain to us why that type of investment to create and maintain 10 jobs is taking so long to be derived at.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And, I know the Honourable Member is, is passionate about that particular facility. I guess it's having family connections there for his daughter being married and so on, I'm sure I understand and we as a department have worked with the operators of that facility over the years and have continued to help provide money for feed for the animals and so on. And But my staff is in discussions with the operators, and I'm awaiting, I guess, the staff recommendation on that. And, you know, I guess we all want to see that facility continue to operate and be a drawing card for the area, to continue to provide good jobs in rural Cape Breton. And so I await my staff's recommendation and see how we can best move forward.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I'm just wondering if the Minister could give us a timeline, because as I say, the letter originally went February the 6th, 2012 to his office. Here we are 15 months later. So I understand that the wheels of government turn slow sometimes, but it is a year and a bit, over a year. We are talking about maintaining jobs, and I just came from estimates with fisheries, and the Minister of Fisheries was telling us how proud he was about putting jobs into rural Nova Scotia, and I agreed with him, by the way. You have an opportunity, Mr. Minister, for a lot less money to maintain 10 jobs in rural Nova Scotia. You've had over a year to look at the case. You said that you were going to meet with the members there, and you indicated your department is doing that to discuss efficiencies and talk about the extent of the extending the grant. But here we are 15 months more or less past, and the people who are volunteers, I might add, on the board of directors there are looking for an answer from you as to at least a timeline, if not a positive answer.
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And again, I recognize the value of that facility to our province. And again, you know, the original agreement was that, you know, the hope, I guess, at least, was that the society would be self-sufficient. And that hasn't quite happened yet. But we're continuing to dialogue with the board of directors. And my understanding is that our staff has been engaged with them. And I'm expecting a staff recommendation back on how we move forward. And Honourable Member, I should have that recommendation, I believe, from my staff by early May.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West.
Well, thank you very much, Madam Chair, and I want to congratulate the Minister on finally giving an answer. In all seriousness, Mr. Minister, the Two Rivers Wildlife Park is a very integral part of the economy of the Marion Bridge area and surrounding areas. There are people that work there, not just from Marion Bridge, they're from Sydney and North Sydney and different areas. And the visitors, as you indicated earlier, come from all over the place. 43,000 visitors is a substantial number of people. And when they have their fright nights and some of the other events they have there, it is a place that certainly is doing its very best to move towards the self-sufficiency that is required. But I can't help but repeat myself in saying that the investment of $80,000 to save 10 jobs is probably one of the best deals that the province can ever hope to get when it comes to actually putting money into a facility for a year. There is a few other items on my list, and we are sort of running out of time for my period, but I'll just let you know that there are things like the Gabbro Seawall, the MV Miner, and more issues regarding the forestry and how some of the forestry contractors in Cape Breton County and other parts of the province are feeling that they're not getting the full benefit of what they should be getting of the investment that was made by taxpayers' dollars into the mill in Port Hawkesbury. And I think that as we move forward, we need to make sure that the people who actually invested the money, which, as you made very clear, was you and I and all the people that pay taxes, that they are getting the biggest benefit of the monies that are being spent in the province of Nova Scotia and to keep the forest industry alive. And there are many questions around Northern Paper and around the Bowater plant in Liverpool area. So we will have much more to discuss. And I understand my colleague from Dartmouth East has some questions, so I'm sure that the rest of the afternoon is going to be, at the very least, enjoyable, might even be eventful. So my time is just about up, I think, Madam Speaker.
Mm-hmm. So 20 seconds.
With that, I'll just I'll sit down and concede my 20 seconds to the member from Dartmouth East.
Thank you. I now recognize the honourable member for Dartmouth.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I appreciate the 20 seconds from the honourable member. It's That's true. And thank you. I'm pleased to follow up on my colleague, the member for Kings West, who began these estimates on behalf of our caucus. I'd like to start by asking the minister a direct question, and maybe I'll get a direct answer on it. Has there been any whole tree harvesting that has taken place in the province in the past 12 months?
The honourable minister. Not quite ready. The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. And certainly, whole tree harvesting had been an issue here in our province for a number of years. And we've committed as a government to do away with whole tree harvesting. And that's been outlined by the previous minister, I think, in December of 2010. And it's an important part of our natural resources strategy that we would no longer allow whole tree harvesting in Nova Scotia. And the major mills in this province do not do whole tree harvesting. Or they're, I'm thinking of Northern Pulp, no longer does whole tree harvesting. And Port Hawkesbury Paper is committed not to do whole tree harvesting. So those are two of our very largest forestry operators in this province. And my understanding is that the amount of whole tree harvesting in Nova Scotia has dropped considerably, and it's somewhere now in the range of about 2% of all harvest in Nova Scotia. So, honourable member, that's the answer to your question, 2%.
The honourable member for Dartmouth East.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So, just clarify, so 2% of the harvesting done in the past year would have been poultry harvesting? Okay, I'm not a nod, so I'm taking that as a yes. And I just want to clarify. So. The minister is correct. The previous minister and this minister have, for 4 years now, said that poultry harvesting will come to an end. 2% is actually a fairly significant acreage. Granted, less than it was, and I acknowledge that it's less than it was. When it's been committed almost every year that it would come to an end, so I'm wondering when will it actually come to an end and there will be no poultry harvesting?
The Honourable, the Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and welcome to the Chair. First time I've seen you there in a little while anyway. So, whole tree harvesting is an issue that, again, we're committed to not allowing in Nova Scotia. And we've been working with various stakeholders and with industry and woodlot owners and contractors. And, you know, we've had some research done by the University of New Brunswick on soil modeling we're working towards an ecosystem-based management system in Nova Scotia, and that every piece of land is different. Every piece of land has different characteristics, and there can be a different harvest technique depending on the water, the soil, the wind direction, just a variety of things that determine how best to use that particular forest resource in that area. So we are committed to, we've been engaged with a number of stakeholders over the last year, and we expect that this will come to a conclusion this spring, and we'll have those whole tree harvesting regulations fully in place by June of this year.
The member for Dartmouth East.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Respectfully, Mr. Minister, or Mr. Chair, the minister can't be all that committed to getting rid of it if for, well, three and a half, almost 4 years now, the previous minister, now this minister, have committed to ending whole tree harvesting, and it's still taking place on 2% of our lands. It's almost like how long it took us to get a clear-cut definition that isn't clear-cut at all. Well, we're getting there. We're getting there. The issue is, so if the regulations on whole tree harvesting are going to come out in June after years of promising that it would end this year, then this year, then this year, then this year, when will those regulations take effect immediately, or will those be yet another year or 2 years before that takes effect? And Mr. Chair, I do recognize the minister said it's only 2% now, and that is a reduction, and that's a good thing. I'm just a bit surprised. I was actually expecting the answer would have been that there was none in the province, and here we are that it is still continuing despite repeated promises over the past few years it would come to an end. It doesn't seem to be. I might even accept the fact that a clear-cut definition might take some time or might have taken some time. I don't accept the fact that it takes a long time to have a definition of whole tree harvesting. That's pretty straightforward. So if he could explain whether those June regulations will result in an immediate cessation of whole tree harvesting in Nova Scotia, or whether it will continue for another year or more, and if it is going to continue, even if those regulations will take place immediately, take effect immediately, whether there will be any wiggle room in them that would still result in whole tree harvesting taking place.
The Honourable the Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And normally, as the Honourable Member would know, the process for regulations, once they're drawn up, once they're approved, then, you know, it has to go over to the Department of Justice for vetting, but that takes a month or two in the normal process. And then those regulations are proclaimed and become effective. So so I think that's the timeline that we're looking at. But, you know, perhaps the best news of all here, Mr. Chair, is that, you know, many of the companies out there are self-regulating. You know, we've talked about this, as you know, and companies are recognizing that, you know, this practice is no longer going to be acceptable, it's no longer going to be allowed. As I mentioned, Northern Pulp no longer does whole tree harvesting. Certainly, Port Hawkesbury Paper is fully committed to you know, FSC certification and sustainable woodlot practices, and no longer or does not do that type of harvesting. JDI has not been doing that on harvesting either, and on the Bowater lands. So really, it's I think it's down to about three operators now in the province that are still practicing the whole tree harvesting. So we're getting there, but mainly it's through education and initiatives by forestry companies themselves to say, you know, this is coming, and we see the writing on the wall. Let's you know, look at better, you know, more sustainable practices. And so we're very encouraged by the fact that forestry companies are taking this on their own initiative.
The Honourable Member for Dartmouth East.
Mr. Chair, I'm certainly pleased that there are companies doing it on their own accord, as they are all over the world, but the question was really about the government promise and the government commitment to ensure that it doesn't happen at all, and the issue is it's still occurring on 2% of land in the province, despite the fact that for almost 4 years now, this government has been promising to put it to an end, and your predecessor stood out on the steps of the legislature and told a crowd that it would come to an end imminently. And here we are years later, and that's a long time to wait for imminently. I can get the exact word. If your predecessor's concerned about the exact word, we have it on video. So you'd be perfectly happy to get him the exact word, but I know people walked away there feeling that it wouldn't happen in the next season. And there were a number of people that responded that they were very happy that the minister had made a commitment that it wouldn't happen by the next season, and we're certainly a few seasons along. Let's move on to the clear-cut, or the definition for clear-cuts. I'd like to get an understanding of how you, and I know there was some discussion about this with the previous member, and so I know he covered some of that. I want to understand how this definition was arrived at, because it is different than what was recommended through the Natural Resources Strategy. Most people in the field argue that it's a much weaker definition. In fact, if you actually look at what this definition means, there are a lot of sites you would go on that would appear to be, that most citizens would call a clear cut, that under this definition would in fact not be a clear cut. They would feel as a clear cut, but by government policy would not. And so it doesn't seem to have addressed the issue that people were looking to have addressed. Moreover, it doesn't seem to be backed up by the science, which I referenced in the House the other day, you'll remember, so I'm sure you've had a chance to look at that, which would indicate that it actually doesn't meet the recommendations around the scientific recommendations around how a clear cut should be defined for the purpose of regulations. So I wonder if the minister would be able to explain how this definition was arrived at, why this definition was arrived at, and why they chose to go in this direction rather than the generally accepted science on the matter.
Before the minister makes a statement, just reminding the honourable member that although there are some times where the member is asking the minister questions through the chair, he's also speaking through the chair at all times. Thank you. The minister.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thanks for clarifying that. The clear-cut definition is, again, a commitment of the Natural Resources Strategy, and we have met that commitment. We've come up with a definition that reads, a clear-cut is a forest harvest where less than 60% of the area is sufficiently occupied with trees taller than 1.3 meters, or that's 4 feet. And that definition was well-researched. It is based on science. We consulted through our staff in the Department of Natural Resources across the continent to see what other research had been done in this regard, to see what other jurisdictions have a policy of clear-cutting or to stop clear-cutting. I know the state of Maine was one example that was looked at, but really right across the whole continent, our staff researched this issue. And we have in our department professional foresters, and people are well trained in sustainable forestry and forest diversification. And we knew that we had to change. We had to get away from the massive clear cuts that have occurred in this province for far too long. In fact, it's estimated that when we came to government, that there was still 96% of the harvesting method in this province was through the clear-cut method, and that was just unacceptable. And Nova Scotians were telling us the same, that they no longer would tolerate massive forest tracts being entirely cut down and being taken away and just left, almost a moonscape left behind. So when the public meetings were held for input into the Natural Resources Strategy, over and over in the communities across Nova Scotia, people were telling us that they wanted change, they wanted positive change, we listened. Through the process of those public meetings and then into phase two and phase three of the strategy, we came up with recommendations that would act upon what we heard from Nova Scotians. And so part of the process also was, dialogue and input from forestry workers, those that are directly involved, whether they're industry or whether woodlot owners, environmental groups such as Ecology Action Center and others. And there were a number of sessions held by staff in the Department of Natural Resources, and both in the classroom, so to speak, and also out in the woodlot. And I can recall last winter, in 2012, having the opportunity to go out into the woodlot. I believe it was in Guysborough and Eastern Pictou County, and spent a day there, in one of those training sessions where woodlot contractors and woodlot owners and others were in attendance and looking at alternate methods of harvesting. And I guess it's various trials were being held with various types of equipment, in various types of stands to determine, how can we better harvest our woodlands rather than just cutting it all down in one swath. And there was a good attendance there by workers from the various pulp mills and sawmills and private woodlot owners and NGOs and others that looked at how best can we, come to the way of doing selection harvesting or alternate methods that would allow something different than clear cut. And so on that day, I was able to rub shoulders, I guess, with some of these folks and saw some of the various machines that were in the woodlot and working around standing trees and picking out, some trees for harvest and leaving others to continue to grow. So, but the model really is based on consultation by all the stakeholders in the industry and here in the province. It's based on the best minds we have in the Department of Natural Resources that provided advice to me as minister on what they had researched around the continent. And it's really based on solid science. And that this is a definition that that was a consensus, I guess, building amongst the various stakeholders. But in the end, I feel confident that it will get us away from this massive clear cutting, and we have a goal, as you know, of no more than 50% clear cutting. And I know already Port Hawkesbury Paper is setting the example and is well on the way. And I think the latest stat I saw from that company was I think it was around 54% they've cut down now in their clear cutting. So they're setting the example, and I know there's lots of other private woodlot owners as well. And we're going to reach that goal within the time frame we said we would.
The member for Dartmouth East.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I agree with you. It should be through the chair, and I apologize for that before. You might want to remind your caucus members in the other room too. We're having good personal discussions with the minister in that room. I think though. I don't dispute the fact that the clear-cut definition based on the definition that you or that the department has defined will be met. That's not really the point. The point is that this isn't what people understood this to be. Mr. Chair, I'm sure the minister has seen the reaction from many of the groups and associations of researchers and so forth. Who, in fact, the headline in the Herald at the time was "clear-cut definition, not clear-cut at all," and there was quite a bit of criticism of that definition from people in that community. And in fact, basically, what you can have is you could have an area that is 60% of it could be clear cut and have no trees over 4 feet, which is probably a little bit taller than the desks in the legislature here, I would guess, and that would not be considered a clear cut. And I don't think that that's the definition that most people accept. In fact, I know, like, I hear from people that isn't what they expected when the commitment was made to significantly reduce clear cutting. And that's where the concern is. There was also an understanding and a feeling at the time that part of this would also move to a requirement on multi-age, multi-species forests, both in terms of moving towards the Acadian forest regime, which is talked a lot about for Nova Scotia, and the minister will be aware of, Mr. Chair, but also that would form part of this, so that as it is replanted and regenerated, that selection harvesting is obviously much more difficult in a forest that is uniformly aged. I think we probably all